made you some content. Daddy made you your favorite open wide. Here comes the content. It's a beautiful day to stay inside.
Greetings, mood killers. I'm Bolognese Francine Marconi, of course, right over there. That's my guy. That's Eddie Barella. He's full of ham. Look at him, Eddie Barella. We are
that's right.
Diplomats of doom and dysfunction. I was bamboozled, Eddie, into, you know how sometimes they get your order wrong on grocery delivery? And I've talked about this. If you're not doing grocery delivery, I don't understand people that are still going to the store, unless you love it or something. It's like
some people do like it for some reason. I don't know. It gives people purpose in life to go there.
Yeah.
And it's stand in the way in the aisle and make sure nobody can pass them.
And the grocery delivery has been available for a long time. I used to get it and people would come to my house and go, "Hey, you know, the grocery store is only a couple blocks away." And I'd say, "Yeah. So wait, you don't want me to use your service or what's the deal? Are you think I'm like, this is just for old people that can't get out of the house or what's going on?" But but occasionally they get it wrong and really wrong. And I had a bunch of items wrong. And get this, I ordered chocolate chip cookies. Now, I know those aren't healthy, but I was treating myself because I love the gooey desserts.
Why not? And sometimes you have to treat yourself.
And instead of chocolate chip cookies, and I have, if they say, well, if this isn't an item that's available, what would you like as a replacement? And I always do that. So, and I wasn't available to interact with the shopper, which was a mistake. And then the shopper, instead of getting chocolate chip cookies, got me oatmeal raisin cookies. And
those can be good, but they're not as exciting.
I feel like they're the enemy of cookies. You know, and the reason is nobody will make oatmeal chocolate chip cookies, which would be the perfect combination. I don't understand why it's not a thing. It seems
illegal.
But I know I've had them in my lifetime. Oatmeal chocolate chip. I believe my grandma made them occasionally. And that's
what I don't like about that, though, is when you don't really know what you're getting in a bite. You don't know if it's a raisin or a chocolate chip.
That's what I mean.
The same once they bake, and then
that's what
I don't like having landmines in my cookies.
I don't have raisins at all in cookies. They don't belong there.
Get them out of there.
The thing is, though, is I had this whole thing of cookies, you know, and I complained. Well, I wrote a report. I said, "Hey, I didn't order these. I didn't want this, so I got them for free." But I'm also like, I'm one of those people. I can't just throw things away like food. So,
well, you have to eat them with hatred.
That's right. So I've been bamboozled into eating oatmeal raisin cookies.
And you're angry about dipping that. It's like the angriest dipping of a cookie into milk ever.
Yes. Oh my gosh. But I had to reorder, and I went ahead and ordered chocolate chip cookies. So then I have chocolate chip cookies and oatmeal raisin cookies in the house.
And you have to eat all of them.
I can't throw anything away.
You got to eat them all. I mean, they're there.
Right. So, I guess. And the thing is, though, and I'll say this, the oatmeal raisin cookies aren't as bad as I remembered they were. I just don't. Maybe when they're fresh, they're really not good because the raisin is so warm and, you know, like, I don't like it. But I don't know. Yeah. It's not the worst thing I've ever had. I don't know what's happening to me. I don't want this. I don't want to like this.
Yeah, but you're going to eat it all, and you're going to, out of spite.
Yeah, that's right, a spite cookie.
Yeah.
That's right.
Right.
But enough of this nonsense, Eddie. We have business to get to. Today on the show, we have so much happening. Have you ever accidentally typed in cat GPT instead of chat GPT? And, it exists. It really does.
Really?
There's cat GPT. It's pretty incredible.
Meow.
Yeah. So you
okay.
Yeah.
Meow, 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 meow.
And you have to I'll have some of those coming up in random audio today.
Oh, okay. Random audio is always fun. And then why did that wheel spinning jackass, Pat Sajak, have to do a few episodes of Wheel without Vanna White?
Oh, no.
Well, I'll explain what happened with I Want to Be Famous, our celebrity news segment coming up.
All this and more on the only show where hope goes to die.
It's me.
That's our phone number, by the way, 833. Hi, it's me. It's Izzy Perry. I found him on TikTok. He was doing like an
kind of
80s.
Like a Devo.
An 80s Taylor Swift cover. I kind of liked it.
Pretty good.
Eddie, I have some random audio for you. Can you tell me what you think of this singer? I'm not going to tell you who it is or anything about it. Just tell me, based on this audio alone, your thoughts on this person's singing abilities. What do you think of that person's voice?
It's just okay. It's fine. It's not terrible, but it's not good. I mean, I'm not impressed by it, really. It seems like somebody you'd hear at karaoke.
Yes. Like, guess who it is? It's
Bono.
It's Gwen Stefani and Gavin Rosdale's kid, Kingston.
Oh, their kid.
Kingston Rosdale. He's
okay. Yeah. He didn't get the gene, huh?
He's 17. He's surrounded by singers. His mom's a singer, performer. His dad's a singer, performer. And his stepdad, Blake Shelton, is a singer, performer.
How cute. You know, I'm going to send him a drum kit for Christmas.
Yeah, Uncle Eddie sent him a drum kit.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I guess if he really wants it, he'll probably keep trying. But it's like one of those things, I guess you kind of have to try to find out. And, you know, he's only 17. Maybe he'll improve with performance. I don't know how that works, but, you know.
Yeah. It could have been a bad night, bad recording. Maybe it does sound better. I don't know. But I wouldn't put that out there. Whatever that was.
You want to don't play it again. don't get that kid out there. Okay, now, Eddie, you know, sometimes people go to these things. I've only recently heard about these. Rage rooms. Have you heard of rage rooms where you go in and smash a bunch of stuff? And I thought,
there's one in Chicago, I think.
Oh,
you can go and it's hard to get into it. It's booked out months in advance. That's the only one I know of.
People are filled with rage. They got it.
Yeah. You smash things. Like old printers and light bulbs.
I don't trust people that I don't know with hammers and stuff.
Yeah, I know.
He's pounding on old cars. It's breaking bottles. Same.
I think I'd prefer some classical music, though, instead of Slipknot.
Yeah, Slipknot is like, it's already there, you know. But I was thinking about that. You know, they still have those axe-throwing bars. And it just, I've never, ever wanted to ever go to one of those. Because
they always serve beer at it too. And I'm like, is this a good idea to have people drinking beer than throwing axes? I want to be away from that. Like, what if you get a bro situation where he gets angry and then there's some toxic masculinity before you know it, they're throwing the axe at you.
And and the thing is too, what I don't understand with the whole thing is, you know, I've seen people, they throw it and they throw it hard. And if the axe doesn't hit right, it bounces back at you. So
yeah, I mean, like, what if that lands on your big toe or something? Like, no thanks. Get me, not gonna do it.
Knocks you around in the head or something. I don't want that. But yeah, I've never. And people still go to them. Like, I just there are officially more axe throwing bars than there are libraries in the country right now. I think. Here's some audio. I don't know when this was done. It was when Will Ferrell made an acceptance speech for the Mark Twain Prize.
But mostly, okay. I would like to thank my lovely wife, Vivica. Before I do that, however, I should really thank my first and second wives, Donna and Julie. Donna, what can I say? We were just too young when we got married. I mean, literally too young. We were 13. Heck, you were 13. I was 9, you know. I was in the third grade, and it wasn't right or legal, but I hope you're well, and I thank you for your support. As for Julie, you left me for Gary Busey, and I will never blame you for that, ever. Finally, Vivica. All I can say is thank you, and thank God I found you. You've given us 3 beautiful boys, and we have a wonderful life together. But I do have to say, sometimes you get a little lippy, okay? You got a big mouth, and you like to run it.
And she's just sitting in the balcony up there just cracking up. Like, you can tell they have a good thing. You know, like, she gets his sense of humor. I wonder if she
Wouldn't that be funny if they were married and she did not get his sense of humor at all? I mean, because every woman I've dated is not a Will Ferrell fan. It's always a guy thing.
Yeah. Eddie, I'm giving you random audio. I know you're a Seinfeld fan. But
yeah.
Which of these is a Seinfeld quote you find yourself using? Because I mean, you know, they've all been overused, of course, over the years, but there are a couple of them in here that I think I still use occasionally just at random.
That's gold, Jerry. Gold.
It's outrageous, egregious, preposterous.
I want it's gone. I want it's gone.
No soup for you.
Well, I got a flash for you, Joy Boy. Party time is over.
When you control the mail, you control information.
Damn it, Elaine, that wasn't Zach. That was the yam yam.
Serenity now, serenity now.
That's one.
And by the way, they're real and they're spectacular.
No, but you're right. It's gold, Jerry. It's gold. That's the one.
Oh, yeah.
I
it's
use
gold.
That. Yeah. I think
that's. What about this one right here? I think this one.
Yeah, the immigration guy said his visa was expired. Poor Babu, everything was going so well for him. He had an apartment, he had a job. What a shame.
Jerry. Yeah, when Jerry says, that's a shame. What a shame.
Shame.
Over and over and over
Babu.
Again.
Babu.
Yeah.
Babu!
Yeah.
And that whole thing was weird because what is it? His immigration papers came to Jerry's house, but Jerry never checks his mail because it's always just junk mail.
Yeah.
And I believe that was the same episode where Wilfred Brimley is involved, right? Because
I think so.
They're all refusing.
Oh, yeah.
They're refusing their junk mail, and Wilfred Brimley has a talk with Kramer. And I came here to, by God, get things done.
Right.
So I love that.
Great show.
So many things on that show. Let's see. Here's another one, Eddie. Dr. Dre talking about hip hop, and I think what he says kind of applies to all music in general.
Let me tell you something. Hip hop is what it is. Anybody that's talking about the state of hip hop right now when talking about it from a negative place sounds like somebody's grandfather.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
I love that.
This is just what it is. Yeah. Hip hop is evolving. If you don't like it, don't listen to it.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm.
I'm keeping it all the way 100 with you. Some of the most of the I don't like. I don't listen to a lot of that, but I'm not hating on it.
Yeah.
I'm never going to hate on it.
Yeah.
It's evolving. And these kids are using what they have at their fingertips. Right. I mean, back in the day, I used to have to go out and buy keyboards and buy sounds from pawn shops like that to get my sounds out. They have everything at their fingertips right now, but you can't be mad at that. This is what it is. If you don't like it, do something about it.
Yeah, change it.
If you don't like what's happening right now, are you strong enough or talented enough to do something new to change it, to make it, to do something that you like?
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, shut the up.
And I agree with him 100%. I feel like that's the main thing with everyone in music in general, like new alternative, new rock, whatever it is. It's never good enough, you know? And I think you gotta take yourself out of it and realize it's not meant for you. And just like a lot of the music you like, it wasn't meant for your parents, you know? So you either like it or you don't like it. But I hate that mentality that you have to, it's a versus. Like it's a new music versus your music. And it's they can never win. So what's the point?
Yeah, I know. I hate that. It's so dumb. It's like if you like the Beatles, you have to hate the Rolling Stones.
Yeah, I never understood
that
either.
You like the Rolling Stones, you gotta hate the Beatles. It's like, can't you just like whatever you want to like? Who cares?
Yeah, I don't follow rules. I just I enjoy what I enjoy. Like, you think normal rock fans are big Taylor Swift fans too? Not every other guy is like, hey, yeah, no, I agree with you on Taylor Swift. So I don't care. I like Taylor Swift. So what? Eddie, there's another, I accidentally typed in cat GPT instead of chat GPT and it exists. I asked cat related questions like, what are some good cat treats for my cat? And I got
meow, 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 meow.
It's actually pretty cool. It gives you GIFs and stuff like that. And then some reasonable answers, but mostly it's just
meow.
So,
right.
But try it if you want to. Cat GPT. It's pretty good. here's one last piece of audio. See, Eddie, if you can get what this guy's message is and what he's selling.
Howdy, y'all. This here's Mike. Down at Mike's Golf Shop, where we buy golf. That's right. We buy golf clubs. Mike's Golf Shop. Come on over here. We buy golf clubs. Over at Mike's Golf Shop. Come on down here. We buy golf clubs. That's right. We buy golf clubs. We buy golf clubs. We buy golf clubs.
It's just...
We buy golf clubs. We buy golf...
I think he was just told... You gotta keep going until it shuts off, and then he just yelling.
Was like, that a TV commercial? Or
I don't know what it is. I think maybe it's a commercial, or maybe it's something on the internet or something where it originated. I don't know, but all I know is if you have golf clubs, he's the guy. If you want to sell them, yeah, that's right.
We buy golf clubs.
Famous. I wanna be famous.
Oh, yeah. Let's see what celebrities are doing. Celebrities are the height of humanity, and we all look up to them. We worship them. So we must see what they are doing and follow their every move at all times and bow down to how great they are. So let's see what's going on in celebrity news. I did say earlier that wheel-spinning jackass Pat Sajak, he had to do an episode of Wheel of Fortune without Vanna White. Oh, no. How could he spin the wheel without Vanna standing over there by herself?
Because she's just there because she's Vanna and people love her. But she doesn't
even turn the wheel, the letters anymore.
Yeah. And it's fine. I mean, what does Pat Sajak really do? You know,
I mean, I get angry that Vanna doesn't touch the letters anymore. I'm upset. I mean, we let her get away with this. What's next?
Yes, it's just been doing it for 40 years.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, you give people an inch, they take a mile. Well, Wheel of Fortune had to do some episodes without Vanna White, unfortunately. I thought that maybe this was them kind of testing to see what it's like to do the show without her.
Oh, no.
Because, you know, when I turned on Wheel, I didn't see Vanna. And my evening was ruined. But it turns out she had COVID.
Oh, so, no.
Yeah, she got COVID. It's that summer COVID going around. She probably got it from me when I had it
so
earlier.
So the schedule, because I know they record ahead like months in advance. The schedule on Wheel of Fortune is so tight, they couldn't have taken a couple of weeks off just to like, hey, you know what?
I know.
Vanna's got COVID. Let's take a break from this. We'll come back and we'll record double.
They record really far in advance, and these episodes that they are recording without Vanna, I guess they're going to air in like 2024. So you're right. Why not just, you know, make that up somewhere? Oh, you can't impede on Pat Sajak's personal time. You know, he only works 2 days a month, and God forbid he has to come in another day.
He's got
to
go out golfing. Vanna, again, we don't have time for you to be sick. And I always wonder that too. Yeah. And those schedules, because they are like that, you'd think like, would you even know if you were watching Wheel, if it was a rerun or not, like a recent rerun? I would have no idea.
This is happening with Jeopardy now too, because of the writer's strike. So,
you know,
they're still making new Jeopardy episodes, but what they've started to do is recycle old questions.
That's not fair, is it?
I know. Is that fair?
I mean, because if you're on that show, the guy who's hosting it now, what's the guy's name? Okay, the Ken Jennings. I mean, he's the kind of guy that would memorize every Jeopardy question. So
I know. Well, maybe they're going back all the way to like the 1950s or something. I don't know.
I'm sure Ken Jennings knows them all. But it is funny that even Jeopardy, they haven't thought like, hey, you know what? How about a guy, while this is going on, let's just try AI and see how that goes.
They're probably saying the recycling, but I bet they're secretly testing out AI questions.
I don't want, you know, people lose their jobs over AI, but if you're sitting there and you're a producer and you have no choice, you have to put something on, like you're either going to go back to the vault of questions, which you're right, like they could mix it up and it could be anything. And who's going to know every question? But it's still like, you know, when you play a game, you know how some people get those board games and they're so good at them because they've played them 100 times. They know all the questions and they're playing with a new friend and suddenly they're just wiping the board with them. And you're like,
it's like that guy you're playing with who owns Trivial Pursuit and he's played it 16,000 times at every dinner party. He brings out the same box of Trivial Pursuit questions. He knows them all.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
so it is kind of like that.
I guess that's the thing, is like the Wheel of Fortune show, they can keep going. The production keeps, because there's no writing involved, isn't there? And I guess
somebody has to write those puzzles.
That's true. Those puzzles. Yeah, who does write those puzzles? I guess I've never even thought about that.
I bet there's a team of like 16 people that come up with those stupid phrases.
Yeah.
Go ahead and spin the wheel.
Oh, see what we get?
Yeah. I just love to spin the wheel. It's so much fun.
There's no reason
to spin that wheel, but, you know, we just thought we would spin the wheel. So, Vanna White, hope that you feel better, because this strain of COVID going around, it's not fun. And, you know, she is 66 years old, looks great, obviously. But, you know, it's a dangerous thing. So they had a teacher fill in for her. Is actually California's Teacher of the Year. And this Teacher of the Year, they're thinking, may actually be eventually the one they're eyeballing to be there and spin the wheel with Seacrust.
No.
So
she's just filling. I bet Vanna will resign or retire or whatever eventually before this is all said and done, and they'll find somebody. But maybe she is the one. Who knows? It's just funny that you said Vanna's 66, and you always feel like when you say a woman's age, you have to say she looks great.
Well, she legitimately looks great.
Yeah, she does. I'm not saying she doesn't.
I know that that is a thing people do. They're like, oh, she looks great. She's whatever age. If you say that past 40, you have to throw that in there. Or a lot of...
Famous... I wanna be famous.
We're taking a look and seeing what celebrities are up to, Marconi, because I know we haven't done celebrity news in a few weeks, and I when we don't talk about what Hollywood is doing, I know we get a little agitated, you and I, and we start to get cold sweats. because we want to know what Leonardo DiCaprio is doing. And it's so important that we stay up to date on celebrity news. It's the highest level of news there is.
I just want to know what celebrities aren't on the picket line, like the ones that have refused to go down there. Like, are there celebrities who are like, I'm not going down there? You know what I mean?
Because Kevin James.
I haven't seen him down there, have you?
I didn't see him. Did you?
It's probably too sweaty down there. I mean, I don't know what his weight situation is now, but maybe he would melt in the sun or something. I don't know.
I don't know, but he looks great for 66.
Looks great. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So, you know, the Barbie movie is very, very popular. Before I tell you some Barbie news, in fact, let me give you a little tease. How much did Margot Robbie earn from Barbie because she's participating on the back end? I'll tell you in a second. But first, I have to ask you this question.
Okay.
Are you going to see the Barbie movie? Do you have any desire to see the Barbie movie?
Well, I saw Patton Oswalt posted somewhere that he saw it and he liked it. He said it was brilliant. And so I'm like, I don't know if this is a joke on the world or if it was a good movie, because I hear from a lot of different people that it's actually good. So I might watch it when it comes out on digital, like as soon as it hits like Amazon and I can rent it for like $3, maybe. You know, I'm not seeking it out.
I do whatever Patton Oswalt says. That's the main thing.
That's right. Yeah.
And he looks great for his age, too, by the way.
Phony baloney.
No, he does look good. Patton Oswalt.
Was he 70? He's looking good.
No, he's not 70. He's like, he's like in his 50s, I think. I don't know. 70. Oh, okay.
Well, yeah, he looks great. He looks great. So, you know who else looks great? Is Margot Robbie for her age. How old is she?
I don't know. 30s? 20s? 30s? Something like that.
She looks great. And
what? Just had to throw that out there.
I mean, I want everybody to know I'm not just saying that about Vanna White. Everyone looks great.
And you're not saying it just about Patton Oswalt either.
That's right. I mean, Margot Robbie, she is very hot. Especially, you know, she's keeping it together at, what is she, 80? But anyways, Margot Robbie, she earned a lot of money.
Margot Robbie's not even close. I mean, she's barely 30, I think, you know.
Oh, okay. Well, she looks great. Barbie. So she's in Barbie. She plays Barbie. And she made a lot of money. A lot of money because she participated in the back end. This has been a big surprise hit. So how much do you think Margot Robbie is going to make off of Barbie, if you were to guess?
I mean, it's a huge success. So a lot of money.
$1 billion.
How much?
Oh, well, it brought in $1 billion globally. Oh. Box office.
So she make at least $500 million, maybe? 25 million? What?
I mean, it's somewhere in between those two. She made $50 million.
Wow, that's great.
In salary and box office bonuses. So look at that. Good for you, Margot Robbie. She also, she's in that superhero movie, right? What is she? Harley Quinn. She's Harley Quinn.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Yeah.
I didn't see that one. And I liked her in Wolf of Wall Street. She was great in that. And
she's been in a lot of good movies. She's a great actress. So
she's one of those people that is like kind of been low radar for a long time. And then suddenly, like, you're like, man, she's been in everything. You know, you kind of realize all the movies you've seen that she was a participant in or one of the main people in. And you didn't even realize she was in it because she's
I had a really big crush on her when they first showed her as Harley Quinn. I thought she looked really nice.
Yeah,
for
60.
Like a little, yes, she's 66, correct? She looks great.
Phony baloney.
I don't know if you've been to the movies since COVID happened. Okay, well, nearly 1 out of 4 of Barbie movie viewers say that they haven't either, but Barbie got them to go to the movies.
Yeah, I don't see that happening to me. I'm glad that people got out and enjoyed something. Good for them. But I can't imagine those theaters because the Barbie thing, it's got to attract a bunch of kids along with adults, and the script is mainly for adults, really, but it's written in a way, from what I understand, that kids wouldn't get the joke. So it's just Barbie and it's you know, funny and whatever, but adults understand the innuendo and whatever, but it's kind of like one of those movies. But then you think about that, you go to the movie theater, no matter what, maybe, you know, during the week in a matinee in the summer, I don't think you have a chance even now of seeing it without a bunch of people screaming and going on and, you know, never shutting up. So,
oh yeah, it is a theater filled with kids too, and angry parents, from what I understand. At least my my friend that took his daughter, he said that he was really angry at the movie because it had a lot of adult themes, and he thought he was walking into a kid thing.
I thought somebody recorded you at the movie theater. This is what I have of Eddie at the theater.
Yeah, whatever. Shut up.
Just little clips.
Shut up.
That's right. As kids were walking by, he was just,
yeah, whatever. Shut up.
So it was odd, you know. So I don't know. But I mean, I'm sure that those parents were like, hey, that guy. And then he did this. Oh, wait, that was me. I'm sorry. That was me.
Well, you know what? We do it like no one else. When Hollywood happens, we're there.
Oh.
I wanna be famous.
Phony baloney.
Looks great for 66.
Eddie, here it is. It's time once again. Did you know? Time to learn something.
Okay.
Did you know Irving Berlin is the only Oscar winner in history who had to present the award to themselves? I guess he won best original song in 1943 for White Christmas.
Okay.
And I guess he had to give it to himself. And the winner is, he said it was really awkward.
Me.
Yeah, and so I guess they
maybe
changed.
After that they learned, you know, if you're nominated in the category, you don't be a presenter. Is that what it is?
That's what they did. They changed the rules.
Okay.
So it was like
how awkward.
Yeah, really. I mean, and how sad. Can you imagine? And the number one morning show in the area. Let me open this up here. Mood. I guess it's Mood Killers, guys. Hey. Okay.
Yeah. Now, when we get our reward or our award, whatever it is, I need James Earl Jones to be giving us the hand over the envelope.
He's like 90, dude. I don't think he's getting out there. Have you seen
him?
He
looks great, though.
You haven't seen him. I haven't seen him in like the last 10 years.
He was in Coming to America, the sequel.
You're right, he was. But did you know, I think they
killed him off in the first 10 minutes.
I think that's because they had to hold him up. I think he's in a wheelchair now.
Yeah, it did seem like he was propped up. But, you know, he looked great.
You just saw a head and then he was draped, essentially.
And I believe he did Darth Vader's voice in one of those movies that came out.
No.
Rogue One.
They AI'd him into those movies. He might have done it from home or something. I don't think he's going in anywhere. That Eddie Murphy movie may be the last movie we see him in, unfortunately.
Well, why did Eddie Murphy kill him in that movie? That's really depressing.
Because he didn't want to film the entire movie. It's probably why. It's like, I got to get out of this.
Yeah.
Eddie, did you know herpes is an ancient Greek word that means creeping? The disease got the name because the blisters would creep across your skin. Ooh.
Ooh. Ooh.
Yeah.
I'm just going to herpes around at night and get myself a little snack from the kitchen when everyone's
asleep. That's right. Well, that's your favorite artist, Herp Albert. He creeps into your heart with his music.
Absolutely.
Here's another one. Did you know, Eddie, powdered wigs became popular in the 1500s because so many men were losing their hair due to syphilis. Now,
wigs.
I wish that this would come back because...
Syphilis?
Yes!
So that...
Yes. Syphilis.
If only there were a syphilis outbreak, I could wear a wig and nobody would bother me.
Eddie, it's Did You Know... These are real facts from real sources. We can't reveal those because...
Real facts.
That's right. Did you know the founder of Kodak, you know, the camera company, Kodak Film, whatever?
Uh-huh. Yeah,
George Eastman hated the months that had different days in them. So he made the company operate on a 13-month calendar with 28 days in each and two left over. He called the 13th month... SOL or Saul.
Huh.
It sounds crazy, but the company used 13-month calendar from 1928 to 1989.
Wouldn't that be annoying if your job made you be on a different calendar than everyone else?
Oh, my God.
That sounds illegal. I bet you couldn't get away with that today.
No. I would, I would quit immediately. And I always wondered why, you know, like Blockbuster, Kodak never really adapted to the real world. They just kept with, they wanted that Instamatic camera, and they tried to make that kind of come back. I think they've kind of resurged with that a little bit, but I don't think they're much of a company anymore. They used to be everything, you know, back in the day.
Right. So right now I do for a little while there. Did you notice there were a lot of people walking around with Kodak shirts on that became nostalgic? I don't know. Maybe they were selling it at H&M or something. I don't know.
That's what the Instagram logo is. It's a Kodak camera, essentially. That's what it's meant to look like.
Right.
Here's another one, Eddie. Did you know author J.M. Barrie lost his 13-year-old brother in an accident as a kid? To comfort his mother, he started speaking and acting like his brother and wearing clothes like his brother. So his mother treated him as if he were his dead brother his entire life.
Wow.
He later wrote the novel
that's weird.
About a kid stuck in an eternal childhood, Peter Pan.
Oh.
Yeah. Whoa,
that came from a really dark place.
Yeah.
No wonder why.
Oh, my gosh.
I mean,
gosh.
Peter Pan in itself is kind of a weird story, but now we know why.
Yeah, it's so creepy, you know, when you think about it that way. This is like, and you've seen these movies before where delusional moms or, you know, somebody's gooey on the sauce or something, and they keep calling their living kid the dead kid's
the dead
name.
One.
It's so weird when parents do that. Or like if a daughter comes in. And like a delusional father, like something's going on. Maybe there's something really bad, and the dad thinks the daughter is the wife who died. You know.
Oh, geez.
It's so creepy.
Yeah, that was very creepy stuff.
Eddie, did you know it's very common for Major League Baseball players to be ejected, but it's more rare for NBA coaches to get the hook. But no NFL head coach has ever been thrown out of a game for arguing with the ref. And it happens all the time in baseball. Like, it's no big deal. I guess that's the only it's so rare in baseball to see any type of aggression, because it's usually, you know, the only other time is if the pitcher accidentally hits somebody and they think they've done it two times, so it must be intentional, and then they go nuts and they go after the pitcher.
I think it's for a real good reason that those NFL coaches don't get into it, because if they got into it with the other coach or an official, you know that all their players would have their back, and before you know it, there's going to be a brawl on the field, and they'd be responsible for
it.
So I'm sure that's why.
And you think about, like, baseball, too. Like, they've got the bat in their hand, and they've got a baseball. I mean, those are two things that you don't want to get, because you see those guys that occasionally get, like, hit in the helmet. And with a 100-mile-an-hour fastball, are you kidding me?
Ugh.
Even if you get hit in the arm, you know, like, you got to
suck
it up. Yeah,
you can break your arm.
You got to suck it up and, you know, keep playing. That's what you'd see all those batters that have, like, basically a husk on their arm.
Yeah.
So if they get hit,
they'll die.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So good luck feeding your family if you... You're a baseball player and you break your arm. You're like, it's not fun.